Hello, and welcome to Jeff and Darby sit down and talk about the state of play for December the 10th, 2019. Yeah. Spectacular.
Nintendo's Indie World program.
Yep, that entire thing is going to be the title of the video.
Yep.
I'm Darby Hallman.
I'm Jeff Mayo.
And that's Malakuma.
Hi.
And we are Nerds at Large. Jeffrey, we watched the state of play today. Mm-hmm. Right ahead of the Game Awards, they're just like sandwiching themselves right up next to it. Like, how can you own the spotlight? Well, I don't know if they'll own the spotlight at the end of the week, but at least for right now, that RE3 trailer is kind of the talk of the town.
Yeah.
So, Jeff, what did you think about that there state of play this time around?
I thought it was a good one overall. They're continuing the whole thing of having at least a couple big things that will be the main talk of it, and to make you keep coming back, then having a bunch of smaller stuff, mixture of VR stuff, some of their smaller first party titles, and just small indie things in general.
Sorry, I was OBS being weird. But what else is there?
I mean, in some ways, this might be as a whole the strongest state of play. We might feel more. I'd probably be more confident saying about that if it wasn't for the fact the Kingdom Hearts trailer leaked and Resident Evil existing and probably being there leaked. If those two things didn't happen, I'd feel a lot more strongly saying that it's probably overall the best state of play.
Yeah, it's hard to, like, I would kind of need to have them all, like, it's hard to exactly remember everything, but not trying to necessarily compare them. I agree. I think there was. It's obviously still the tone of state of play and just the announcements and stuff in general. At least so far, you're never really expecting it to be like a big thing after big thing after big thing. You kind of know at this point the pace of it's usually going to be some updates of games you've already seen before, one or two smaller announcements, and then usually one big thing at the end.
Yeah, like, and sometimes
I definitely feel like there's at least been one state of play that didn't even have that big thing at the end.
I think it was the first one. The big closer was a Mortal Kombat trailer, which was like
It was like almost the exact same trailer we had seen. I think there was a few new things in it, but
it actually did announce a couple characters in there technically, even though there were characters we knew that were coming.
Yeah,
but yeah, I think that one had a good showing of like VR title and stuff, even if that's not for everyone.
Yeah,
this one just had, I would say, it had obviously the big announcement of Resident Evil. It had a big expansion thing for Kingdom Hearts announced. The Babylon's Fall, coming out of nowhere and finally making a comeback. So like, hey, this game still exists. And kind of the same with Ghost of Tsushima.
Yeah, even though, like, at least just for with Ghost of Tsushima, it's just one of those things that even though they never said anything about it, it's like the Sony first party thing, like we all know that it's coming soon. Like the fact that they're not just gonna like stop talking about it or whatever and let it fade away. Babylon's Fall is something that like most people had forgotten about, and if that just like never came back up, it's not like people would have. It's not like it really would have came up that much.
And I started like in like you know there Babylon's Fall, I was like, oh nice, finally.
Yeah. and Babylon's Fall, like that one time, that was the only time we saw it, right?
Yes,
that
E3
Square Enix thing. And that was nothing. It was just like, here's this lore dump. You don't even know what this game is. Like, it's platinum, so you can assume maybe it's action, but you literally had no clue. Like, we had nothing
to go off of. Platinum
and
Square, that's all you got.
Yeah, so like, which one are they going to go towards? Is it going to be Platinum's making an RPG, or is it going to be Square's making an action game? And turns out Square's making an action game.
Hell yeah. I mean, look at the last time they did that, Nier.
Yes, it's true.
You're talking about, baby.
This is true. I guess you want to like get into it.
Yeah, we kind of just go for it.
Piece by piece, go through this thing. I'll skip through a little bit.
They started with a game everyone loves. Untitled Goose Game.
The Goose is Loose on PS4. It's one of those things I'm like, wait a minute, this isn't on PS4?
Yeah, that was a lot of people's reactions. Like, yeah, it was only announced. And it's only on PC and Switch.
Interesting.
But it's also, Darry, I don't know if you saw this. I was coming to Xbox on Game Pass.
I did see that, yeah.
It's like, which is, well,
arguably the bigger announcement.
I do like it because they just, the moment they got pretty much this happened and they got the go-ahead to announce it was coming to the other consoles, the Game Pass Twitter's like, public service announcement, Untitled Goose Game's coming to Game Pass. Like, yeah.
Oh, I even saw like the at least the tweet I saw, unless it was doctored up, it had the PSA, but it was like, it was very like casual. It was like lowercase letters. It was basically like, oh yeah, we got it too.
It's like, yeah, it's getting the Game Pass. Yeah. Not just Xbox, but Game Pass.
It's like, we'll let Sony do that big announcement. It's like, oh yeah, but you can get it for the service you already have.
Yeah. Yeah.
Obviously, like this game has done really well on the platforms it already has. I'm sure it coming to PlayStation's a big deal, you know. For as much as I was a little bit let down in the game, it's, you know, it's charming and it's good. That's gonna do well. It was definitely one of those things that, like, when we started out with this, I'm like, you know, like, this is not that big of an announcement. Like, it's not that surprising that it's coming to PlayStation.
Yeah.
I was a little worried. I was like, ooh, this is what we're starting with. You know.
No, I agree. But. Good game coming soon.
Yeah. No, it is definitely still a good announcement. Then we moved on to, oh, I actually think this looks pretty good. This is what's the name of this game?
What's this one?
It's a battle royale, but it's all
Spellbreak,
like
Spellbreak, a battle new battle royale combining role play and magic combat from Proletariat. It's starting a closed beta.
Yeah, so it's a battle royale, but it's all like you're using fantasy, like crazy magic stuff, like almost anime-esque, like Super Saiyan stuff.
Yeah,
like,
and
this looks like at least on the surface, kind of looks more appealing to me than some other battle royales, because it just has a very unique angle to it. I don't know if it struck you in any similar way. But.
Oh no, I thought it looked cool. I was curious about, because when we think battle royale nowadays, we're like, oh, 100 people and blah, blah, blah. And this looks like it might have no more. I think we only saw at most like 6 on screen at a time.
Oh, really? Yeah.
I felt that way.
I guess I was too busy just looking at the flashy
moves.
Which
makes more sense considering how, comparatively, how flashy and how, you know, there's a lot more going on it. It makes sense from a, you know, making sure that it runs well perspective, honestly. Yeah. I mean, I might be completely wrong. It just might be they just did it for the sake of the trailer, so it's not as chaotic as it.
Yeah,
you know,
I guess I wasn't even thinking.
But the place
about
is big, and you're still dropping from the sky, so it probably has a lot more people than.
Yeah, it might not be 100, but I imagine it's probably more than like 6. Because based off of in this one trailer, I've seen like 4 different types of environments. You know, it's like. So I imagine this.
I am curious because, again, part of the reason this is the way we look at Battle Royale, like you just jump in the world with nothing and get stuff. I wonder if it's the same way. Like you find stuff that gives you the type of magic you have, or you select that in the beginning. And it's kind of like a team. It's like the Apex, where you start as a team and you got to work on the comp. Kind of like you're picking characters.
Yeah.
It's more like Apex than Fortnite.
Either way sounds cool to me. But,
yeah. I can't remember. Did they say there's a free-to-play thing?
I don't know if they said it. I can, whatever, we can find that out later. Yeah. But either way, like, I was definitely, you know, whenever you just talk about, like, a new Battle Royale, I was more interested in this than I expected.
Yeah.
I would, just from them saying that at the beginning.
Because,
I mean, the art style was cool, and just the idea, the whole vibe of, you know, part of why I can't get into Fortnite is just the building and everything. Mm-hmm. And even Apex is kind of more too traditional multiplayer shooter for me. But this looks, you know.
It is out on PC right now in the Epic Game Store in alpha.
It's out now on
the Epic Game Store? It's out in alpha on the Epic Game Store.
Okay.
And it's going to be in beta spring 2020 for PS4.
Okay, sweet. Yeah. I'm interested. I'm definitely. It looked fun.
I mean, if you're interested, we can not or anything. We can do our research. Maybe look at doing a PC instead if you wanted to.
Yeah. I am intrigued.
Next dream. Okay, so Darby, we knew this was gonna be in here, but they did exactly what we didn't want them to do.
What was that?
just show a trailer and didn't show the features of why this is a supposed to be the big release. But I do give them credit for, as far as they're doing the trailer stuff, I think they did a good job of showing, hey, this is kind of all the crazy stuff dream that people have made in dreams is how far people have taken it.
That's what I was going to say. Like, on the surface, I think this was a good trailer.
I think it was too. But they might do what we want later on, closer to release, which is...
Yeah, I get what you mean. And I guess maybe it's telling that I wasn't even thinking about it that way. I was about to come in here and be like, this was just a really well-made trailer.
Oh, no. It was. It's a great trailer.
Because it just shows off, like, I mean, a lot of this stuff looked more like a complete game to me, just where it's like, it's crazy how many different things you can do in this, but... Kind of, I mean, like, you're kind of right. I wasn't thinking about it that way because I guess I was too wrapped up.
Play that one.
And how, yeah, I was too wrapped up in how cool the trailer was.
We just need to do another dream stream soon.
We do. I mean, and it even rhymes, you know. Yeah. but you're kind of right, though, because I mean, technically, even though I think this is the best showing of what dreams can currently do, none of this was said like, yeah, this is what's new in here. This was more of a generic, you know, the generic dreams trailer.
But, yeah, it's kind of more thinking about it and just seeing reactions. I did see some positive things about this. I feel like maybe in a way, a reintroduction, because while Dreams has had announcements and stuff, and it's never been this is the first time in a long time that Sony's actually presented Dreams like this in their own thing. So I guess it's not as, we can step. So reintroduce it to people, yeah, just showing what people can make in Dreams, like, oh, it's more like. Because, as you mentioned, I think our discussion when we were talking about what we think of State of Play, most people kind of saw the PT remake thing in there and nothing else. But
that was like the only thing I saw kind of take off, you know?
Yeah. And trailer's good at showing, like you said, look at all these pretty full-looking game-type things. Like, all these different experiences, all these different art styles, all these different types of games that are made in this thing.
Yeah.
And you can go on there and play all these and more when the game releases, because I guess they've went ahead, I guess they've already had and taken it off the early access.
They had a date.
Said at some point this week. I just assumed it was before the State of Play, which... Yep.
Which, I mean, I guess on its surface, like, them saying, like, look at all these things that you can do in Dreams is kind of no different than what they've already did with the early access, and this trailer is not really saying, like, this is what is specifically different. But, like you said, they're also trying to appeal to people who either have never seen Dreams, never tuned into the early access, or kind of forgot it existed.
Also, just kind of... State of Play hasn't been something so far where they get on the details like we are looking for.
Yeah.
That's probably
good. Where do you think is their next big marketing opportunity, though?
This is the unfortunate... Yeah, this is the thing that kind of just... I think their best chance is maybe a State of Play thing where they did this reintroduction trailer type thing, and then the next trailer, they may do a State of Play about the time it comes out, a little before it comes out.
It comes out...
February 14th, maybe one early February, where it kind of goes over that stuff, or beforehand. I'm sure Meteor Molecule will do their own streams for it, but I think they need to, you know, put it in a more way that's easily accessible and more people will see it.
Yeah, they're gonna need to show like this is the campaign or the equivalent of that. Mm-hmm. And I still honestly don't see a way this catches on very well. I mean, and if it catches on, it's probably going to be little that Media Molecule did and more that, like, you know, the fan community goes crazy. But I still see this being a game that 20 years from now, there are still people who are, like, so ride or die with Dreams and dedicated, that's all they play. But I think it's going to be a pretty niche community.
Yeah.
And I think they're going to be carrying on long after Dream support has died.
Yeah. I agree with you, the niche thing. And that'd be more okay if it didn't take this whole generation to make. Because Dreams was announced, I believe, at the PS4 reveal event.
That, yeah. That sounds right. It was at the very least that year, that around that time.
Which is the crazy thing.
Well, if you think about it, it went from like Sackboy was basically the de facto PlayStation mascot for the PS3, and then now Media Molecule has released not a single thing in this entire console generation.
Yeah, the only... Well,
Tearaway.
Yeah, and Little Big Planet thing.
Yeah. Was that... I thought that was on PS3.
It might have been cross-gen. I'm pretty sure that was at least a PS4 title.
Okay.
But, yeah.
But, I mean, you know, still, case in point, they've been quiet.
But I think I saw this is a $40 box thing. Like, it's going to be $40, which I think it's a good price for this.
Yeah. I hope. I'm pulling for him. I mean, like I said, it was a well-put-together trailer. It's just I don't know what exactly they have to do to really cut through the noise. And unfortunately, it's not a good time. This early 2020.
And just saying it, I did not count as a VR title since they didn't show VR, even though we know there's going to be VR in it.
Yeah, but there was no VR in said thing.
They showed VR. I would have counted it.
Now, this is a game, this next game. What's the name of it? I know we've seen this at other places several times.
Superliminal.
Okay. I mean, like, well, no, it's not a podcast. So you're watching this with us if you're listening to this video. So this is the game with like crazy optical illusion stuff. Like, this totally looks like a game I would play with my sister.
Oh yeah,
it would be a fun. Like, it looks very, very, very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
It's like a puzzle. I don't know. I feel like puzzle games can be kind of hard to stand out of the puzzle game sometimes, but this looks like one that absolutely will.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
looks neat.
I'm super down. I'm interested, like, what the context is here, because they keep hinting at like some weird stuff going down, but like this,
yeah,
the wake up sign. But I mean, like, you have to admit, this is like very unique. Never seen a video game like do weird optical illusion puzzles before. It's very interesting.
I'm all for it.
Yeah, me too.
I will keep an eye out.
It's one of those that's just immediately unique. Like, I could show this to my parents and be like, "Oh wow, that's cool," you know?
Yeah, that's neat.
So yeah.
Yeah.
Superliminal.
Yeah. This is that weird VR game, Paper Beast. VR sandbox game where you explore an ecosystem full of strange beasts. Coming out first quarter 2020.
Does this do anything for you?
It's immediately visually striking. It looks like it'd be cool. But then as I went on, they didn't show anything interesting that you actually do.
Yeah, I'm kind of in the same boat. I mean, it's an artsy-fartsy game. Like you said, visually striking. But like, I just have a feeling this would end up being kind of empty experience.
Yeah.
Probably very short and just kind of, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Monsters made out of paper.
Yep.
It's interesting. But I have to admit, didn't do a ton for me.
That thing was shitting sand.
I mean, wait, you don't shit sand?
Darby, you gotta go to the doctor.
Damn. Alright, we gotta stop the pack. We gotta stop the show. Alright, can we move on from Paper Beast?
Yeah, yeah.
Alright. Where are they flying to, Jeff, though? Are they going to Paper Heaven?
They're going to the better game, Tearaway.
They're going to...
And I don't mean as a slight against this game. I just love Tearaway.
This Tearaway is just really good. Yeah. Like, no disrespect.
Yeah. Hell yeah, baby.
So why is her face so like thick? It just looks like her face, like they blew her face up.
I don't know.
Something about her face looks very unnatural to me.
I think it's the angle.
Yeah. I've always thought that every time I see that image. Did we already talk about this on the podcast?
Yeah, we did. We did, but we have details of what exactly are in the past and all that stuff and the price and all that, which is
still,
what
still
we can.
So weird that Aerith is like a child. And so is Yuffie. Like, look how tiny she is.
Yeah, she looks more like her Kingdom Hearts 1 design, but I think she's wearing like her Kingdom Hearts 2 clothes, but she still looks young. I don't know. So yeah, in the normal DLC thing, for $30, which I'm paying, you get the additional story Remind, limit cut episode, whatever the hell that means, and 13 boss battles, secret episode and boss battle, data greeting feature, slideshow feature, premium menu, Darby.
We got not just a casual wimpy premium.
premium and diverse difficulty settings and gameplay challenges. That's all in the DLC, Darby.
Sorry, do you have more to go on with that? I can wait till you're done. I said I can wait till you're done.
Additional stuff. They got the Kingdom Hearts 3 Remind and concert video of 19 tracks for $40. So pretty much for an extra $10, you get a concert video. And then they added free DLC main story update. So that just means they're going to be extra scenes in the actual main stories. That guarantees I'm replaying this motherfucking game. new abilities added, new keyblades, and new form changes. Blah, 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 and some sharing feature stuff.
Isn't it like the most Square Kingdom Hearts thing in the world to do? To literally flash this up for like a second. Like, there is absolutely no way that anyone could have read that whole thing on the stream without
I was like, wait, what's going on? What's going on?
Oh, that's really funny. Look, it's space in the trailer and space in the background.
Now, the more I watch the trailer, the more I love it. It's just, honestly, this DLC is just giving me everything else I wanted out of Kingdom Hearts 3, it looks like.
That's awesome.
So, unfortunately, not coming out before the end of the year, so I can guarantee this might
be. Let me see if it's actually as fast as it felt like it was to me. When I was watching it, it was just like, bloop, oh, now it's gone.
And I was trying to look through and like,
Yeah, that's like not long enough to read that thing.
Yeah, so I'm excited about this. I think the price is fine considering all they looks like they are putting in the game.
Yeah.
I know it's one of those things like times have changed and all that, but we got less than that and they released the game again that you had to buy. That's just the way it used to be. Like, yeah. They always had like a final mix version of all their games, which added stuff, and this seems to be more substantial than those, which makes me really happy. And from what I'm seeing, especially now that I've had more time to look at it since the podcast recording, a lot more Kingdom Hearts fans are very happy with what they're seeing, that and hoping that this fixes whatever problems they did have, rather be the difficulty, some story stuff, yeah, the lack of boss battles and all that. This seems to be fixing most people's problems. And yeah, and the Final Fantasy characters as well.
I do always, though, think it's worth calling out, because I hate when developers lock higher difficulty behind a paywall.
Yeah, the difficult thing, excuse me, I think they added difficulty, like they already added a more difficult thing to it already in a free update.
Yeah.
And so people have already replayed it. I was just waiting until
this came out. I just have to mind it, like, I feel like any just like additional difficulty thing, no matter how many you do, should just be free.
I don't disagree. I'm not even sure what that difficulty thing is, because like I said, I think the higher difficulty thing they've already added might be a difficulty higher than that or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
Anyway, I'm excited for this. I'm playing it. Sorry, Kakarot.
Sweet. Sweet, sweet.
And then we got Predator again. Predator's Biden got a release date of April 24th.
Bad release date, but I mean, we'll say that about any... It's kind of unfair. We'll say that about any game that's coming out around that time. But I think this game looks fun. I mean, yep, like, we didn't really get to see a ton of, like, we got to see...
We saw, like, 10 seconds of gameplay or something.
Yeah, which we have seen more in the past. I mean, yeah, you know, this was kind of just a trailer. Most of what I've seen previously...
Go back a little bit to the, when the heat vision... I like the way that looks.
Yeah,
cool.
Yeah, which is like the Predator movies. I mean,
yeah,
most of what we had seen before had been focused on the people, so it was cool to see a trailer focused on being the predator.
And you get a bunch of different Predator class resolve. You got female Predator. Also, something that's obviously not going to be in here. This is coming to PC.
Okay.
Which will make some people very, very happy.
So is it just Xbox, PS4, and PC, or...?
It is only PS4 and PC because this is Sony published.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that.
It's just one of those things. Sony's looks like they're being more open to putting stuff on PC. And it's just suddenly happening and people aren't talking about it.
They've come a long way from protecting the kids.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it makes sense. I mean, we don't talk about this much, but the MLB The Show is going to be multi-platform.
Yes. Yeah, so we should talk about that on the actual podcast feed, because...
Yeah.
I don't want to spend too much time on this video, and we don't have enough time right now to devote to how big that is.
Yeah.
But obviously, this was the people who did the Friday the 13th, which was fun but very, very flawed game. This feels like, I mean, I'm hoping that they can avoid the jankiness pitfalls, and from what I've heard, like, the online connectivity was terrible.
Yeah, the good news is there are multiple good things about this compared to Friday the 13th. This has Sony backing. This has official backing from the property owners that they're actually doing stuff for.
Not like lawsuits that keeps them from updating their
game. Yeah, this is actually, you know, 20th Century Fox is right there.
Yeah.
That is very important. And I think the good news is this is already looking more polished than the last time we saw it, even in the minimal gameplay, my opinion. Yeah. And we still got another four-ish months for more polish.
Yeah, I agree. No, I'm optimistic, and I think Predator is just such a perfect franchise for this because it's kind of like wacky, so you can like kind of do weird stuff, and you can continue updating this game and put like crazy over the top skins in there, and it's not going to break it. It's like, it's Predator, it's supposed to be campy and stuff like this, and just the whole like them being a predator and a bunch of people or whatever, like it fits that the same vibe that they did with Friday the 13th so well. But I think the Predator kind of lets them do a lot more because Jason was pretty static. Like Jason was Jason. Mm-hmm. But in here, it seems like you can be, they introduced like three different classes of Predator, and that alone already seems better than Friday the 13th.
Oh yeah. I'm surprised more people haven't done the whole, small group of people against one like monster type thing.
They tried what was the game that failed?
Evolve,
yeah. Which seems to be more people so cool.
Yeah.
They were probably scared off because of Evolve.
Probably, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Moving on. Right. Babylon's Fall,
Babylon's Fall, out of nowhere.
Making the resurgence. I was like, oh, neat.
I'll be honest. I am absolutely not the one they're targeting for this. So like, who really cares what I think? So I'll like move on pretty quickly. Like, I'm just like, no platinum game has really ever spoke to me that I can think of besides Bayonetta.
I was saying
Bayonetta's like the only one. This is kind of one that like, the environments look cool enough, but like kind of as soon as this happened, it was just kind of like, all right, we have a lot of these. Like we just have a lot of like, and I don't know. Like I'm. Action games like this are not necessarily my thing. I can get into them every now and then, like Devil May Cry and Bayonetta. Mm-hmm. But like at some point, they all just kind of run together to me. And just nothing about this one. Like it's definitely not bad. It looks really cool and flashy. But there was nothing like immediately that jumped out was like, this is unique. Like even Astral Chain, I feel like, had more that jumped out with the like, oh, this like cool city and these cops that have this like link with this like these animals or something. It's like, this is a cool unique hook, you know what I mean? And when I watched this, it kind of just looked like, okay, it's fantasy stuff with big monsters and flashy sword, you know what I mean? It was just like, for me personally, it was cool where
the guy uses the like a chain thing to grab the boss's giant ass sword to use against him.
Yeah, like, all right, sorry, you go ahead. I just wanted to give my
I think this game looks neat. I need more than just the flashy combat though, because I don't have the most experience with Platinum. Played some of Bayonetta. And some Wonderful 101. Obviously, I played Nier Automata. So, no, like a Platinum nut. This combat reminds me a lot of Nier Automata, just the way it looks. Just the way the character moves and just the way the weapons and all that.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I need a little more. I'm interested to see, like, how much of a story focus it is compared to some other Platinum games. Because depending on the franchise from Platinum, story and all that kind of stuff and world building and all that, it's to a varying degree.
Because, compared Nier to, like, Astral Chain. And,
Nier to Bayonetta, which Bayonetta has, you know, fun characters and all that, but the story is nothing to write home about, and that's not the point of it. We're near, while people enjoy the combat or anything, the thing everyone talks about is the characters and the world and lore and all that.
Which I think a huge, huge part of that is
Yoko-Taro. Oh, yeah, 100%.
Is Yoko-Taro is the biggest reason for that.
But, yeah, and part of it just depends on, I think, who they're working on this stuff with. So, it's Square Enix. I'm curious to see where this ends up falling on the Platinum spectrum.
Yeah, because even just Platinum quality in general with their games is also very variable.
Yeah.
I mean, they have more hits than misses, but they do have some misses.
I think they do, but I feel like the most of their misses are with the licensed crap.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know if I should take that first showing of this game with the lore dump to mean that it is going to be story focused, or is that just like that was all they had to show about that game? Because that's what that felt so, like, is that we're forced to show this game, but we have nothing.
Yeah, I think it's more of that, considering it's been about a year and a half since we saw the game, yeah. And now we're just finally getting a little bit of gameplay. We're not seeing it again until, well, they said summer, so I'm guessing it's at E3.
Yeah,
that's probably, the safe assumption.
That is a safe assumption.
And then it probably won't come out till late next year at the earliest.
So this will be hidden in the middle of an abysmal Square Enix press conference. They won't have Final Fantasy or Avengers
or to talk about. Yeah, or Sony if they're back.
Yeah,
because obviously it looks like they have the marketing stuff.
Or both. It could be at one and tease the other.
This is true, though. I feel like if Square doesn't have something to follow up Final Fantasy and Avengers, they should just not bother, but they will anyway.
About to say, Jeff, the year prior to that, they shouldn't have bothered, but they bothered anyway. And yeah. You and Will had to like wake up and go there and react to that.
My hope is they have a near follow-up.
I just, like, I don't have faith in Square, like, putting together good shows. Like,
oh, I don't either.
That last show was bad. It just happened to have Final Fantasy VII and Avengers to make it worth our while.
But even though Avengers didn't blow us away. Final Fantasy.
This is true.
Final Fantasy did, though. That was fantastic.
Ooh, babe.
Baby. Yeah, more info next summer. I'm glad they're kind of forefront. Like, you know, they were honest with us, like, hey, you're not seeing it till the summer, so don't expect it.
Yeah, yeah.
I can respect that.
All right, this is the big one. The big one. All right, as we were saying before we started recording this and some at the beginning, we wanted to kind of save it. If the leak didn't happen, man, what a reveal. It's cool even without it. I'm not saying it's not cool, but like you can obviously tell they were counting on you not knowing this. They were counting on the surprise because to come out and like have the Project Resistance, and it's like I think we'll be dissecting this for a long time because them doing that. Like if you don't know exactly what happened, they like the Project Resistance is the multiplayer Resident Evil game they announced like a month or two ago, and then they said in here like we're going to show you the campaign version or whatever the campaign mode of that game, so they automatically like you're not ready for Resident Evil 3, and then like boom, it's Resident Evil 3, and yeah. Like. We kind of lied, but not really. You know, we kind of lied, but kind of didn't because the multiplayer game is included with RE3, but this is not the campaign mode. This is RE3.
Yeah.
And where I was going to get with it, that shows a level of self-awareness that video game marketers don't often have. Because they're self-aware that the Project Resistance is a less hype announcement. You know what I mean?
No, and then, yeah, I think that's awesome. On their part of the fact, like, me and you showed a little interest in Project Resistance. Like, this could be a cool thing. If we hear good things about it, we might consider picking up at the price point. Now it's like, I'm going to play Resident Evil 2 pretty soon. I'm going to assume I'm going to love it. I'm going to assume I want to get this right away. And then while I Project Resistance, we can try it out.
Yeah. I mean, this is great for Project Resistance because now it's going to go from, oh, should I take a gamble and buy Project Resistance to, yeah. I already played RE3. I freaking love it. I need more Resident Evil.
It'll already have a player base and built in because this thing is going to sell.
Yeah.
This is going to sell crazy. Also, note, they also announced, I believe, I'll pull up the thing while I'm talking, but that Resident Evil 2 has eclipsed 5 million copies.
Nice.
And it is now sold over the original.
The fact that Capcom could like recognize that, had the self-awareness to recognize that Resident Evil Resistance is the thing that you have to sell or whatever, is the thing that people are like less hyped about, and that RE3 is what they really want, and to kind of do that bait. Like, not only did you do the bait and switch to throw them off the scent, but then you're also like kind of propping up Resistance is gonna do so much better now than we thought it would have. And we thought it would do fine, but it's gonna do a lot better now. You know, there's gonna be more eyes on it in general. And like, I don't know, I was just kind of blown away. This is something that I don't feel like many marketing teams would have done.
Yeah.
Like, we talked about Square Enix. There's no way. No way in hell they could have had this level.
This just continues the whole thing of Capcom just killing killing it, baby.
Did they just get rid of everyone who used to work there? Just like replace everything? Like something happened.
I don't know if Kotaku got the joke. They have on here Resident Evil 3 Remake will come to PlayStation 4 on April 3rd, blah, 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 blah. Along with Project Dits, an online survival game with its own campaign mode. I don't think they caught
the joke.
Yeah,
I don't think they got the joke.
But, again, so I mentioned it. One of the other, the biggest surprise of all this, it's coming April 3rd.
Yeah, we haven't even talked about that yet.
Something that made me kind of surprised when this was leaking is like, oh, this is coming now, is the fact that we expected it to be like late next year, if it was coming next year at all. But we doubt it, Capcom. They're continuing their trend that they've been doing for a couple years at this point that we should just believe that they're going to do from now on, where there's a quick turnover between announcement and release date.
Yeah. No, yeah, that's the continuous.
And this is closer than what they normally do.
Yeah, no, this is. We thought that RE2 was already like, wow, that was E3 to January, right?
Yes, which is what they did with Monster Hunter and RE7.
Oh, yeah, it was, yeah.
So, again, they've been doing this, so we had no reason to doubt them. We did. And.
Well, now, like, you won't be doubting them anymore. Now you're going to be inspecting. Like, it is absolutely, like, bonkers. That they release RE2 last January and it's as good as it is, like, potential game of the year at the Game Awards and game of the year for, like, a lot of people. Like, it is, like, gonna go down in history as a truly phenomenal game. And then you're able to release what looks like the same thing for Resident Evil 3 1 year later. Like, the fact that they had the bandwidth and the team and everything to be able to make both of these games, obviously, at the same time. I mean, like, I think it's very clear that RE3 was being made during RE2's
I think what Jacob texted about was true, and what I mean for the people listening is, apparently, Jacob Hamill, frequent guest on here.
Leaker.
Yeah, leaker. Professional leaker. He knows all the Smash characters. Go bug him on Facebook. He said he read somewhere online that apparently Resident Evil 2 and 3 were being made concurrently and planned to release as like a dual pack thing, but they both got so big that they decided to release them separately. Partly, I guess, so they can focus on RE2, get that out in a timely manner, and then be able to give RE3 time it needs to. But if that's true, and I can see it doing it considering how close these are together as far as release time, that definitely works out for them considering RE2 alone sold 5 million copies, and this will sell, even if it's not that much, it would sell at least 4 million, I'm going to assume.
Yeah.
Easy.
Yeah. It's freaking crazy. It's crazy that this is happening.
One thing I am curious about, and this is going to be one of those things where people who know Resident Evil more than me would be able to probably answer. In the trailer, when they're doing the whole thing where before we know it's RE3, and even afterwards, we know what it is. They show Jill looking in first person, and that's how you're playing. I'm curious what that's all about.
This is one of those things. Like, it very well might end up having some first person thing to it. My take on this was that, again, I think they were making this trailer expecting people to not know what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
I think the first person was just so that you had the build up to the Jill reveal.
Yeah, but like, I agree with you. I felt that too. But then later in the trailer, I think they kept on showing some things where you're Jill in first person.
Okay.
So maybe think, okay, it might be something that's mixed in the game. It might be a choice or something. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe. Right, maybe some sort of bridge between the RE7 style and the style, which I don't know if that would be good or bad, but I mean, like, we'll see how it goes. Yeah, I just figured it was you wanted people to still think that this was a Resistance campaign mode until, boom, Jill. Yeah. It's like, oh, shit.
Well, we could probably know more about it because it's something I don't think either of us had time to watch. I don't even know if you know it existed, but there is a developer video where they show gameplay.
Oh, yeah. Sweet.
So we'll have to look at that at some point. We can look at that and then talk about it with Jacob some before Game Awards.
All right. Yeah.
They got the classic costume pack, blah, blah, blah. Then they do a little 25-year PlayStation thing where it's made of like, is this the end? There's no way you guys are ending on this.
Yeah.
It's a nice little thing.
But yeah, we don't need to talk about it. And it was not, I mean, Not too much left, but
show a nice little scene from Ghost of Tsushima.
It's just it's back.
Little junk food, just a little tiny taste, just a little appetizer.
Yeah, tiny tease for Ghost of Tsushima. And
at
then,
the Game Awards.
Yeah, and then they're like, tune in to the Game Awards. Yeah, that was kind of surprising to me. I thought the whole blowout was going to be here. I was surprised that they were pushing the game. I mean, I think it's smarter for the game.
Yeah, I think it's smarter because there'll be more eyes on the Game Awards than here.
Oh, it's objectively smarter. I just didn't think they were going to do it. Yeah, Sony's been very kind of closed off from everything. I just kind of didn't expect Sony need to be showing a game at the Game Awards, but we need to remember that like Ghost of Tsushima, even though we're hyped for it, unlike like Ghost of Tsushima needs to be sold. It's not a name that like The Last of Us, they Sony cannot do a single other marketing thing at all and just drop The Last of Us and it's gonna freaking sell. Mm-hmm. Same thing with God of War, same thing with Spider-Man. Ghost of Tsushima is a completely new IP from a developer that's not like, I love Sucker Punch, but Sucker Punch is not like one of the household developer names that everyone in the world knows. You know, yeah. You have to be a little more into the stuff to know them.
They're so. Like, and I love them too. I'm a huge fan of the Sly Cooper and Infamous franchises, though. So I played and loved every single one of their games since Sly 1.
Yeah, I'm speaking for someone that Sly Cooper is like one of my favorite franchises of all time.
But they are. At right now, I would say a step below Naughty Dog and Santa Monica, but this is a game that could easily, like with Guerrilla Games, take them to that level.
They are like Insomniac several years ago. Yeah. They're like Insomniac before they broke out, really. Like,
yeah. Also, Darby, well, as far as you say of selling this game, I got news for you. You might have seen this. Jeff Keighley, you know, of course, posted about being in the Game Awards. He said, quick aside, this is our longest trailer of the show on Thursday, which I think this is a good choice to have the longest trailer.
Yeah. When they say, we really need to see gameplay for this thing.
That's why I definitely think we're seeing that.
Like, I'm hoping that this fight, it transitions into gameplay. I hope it's not just like a CGI fight the whole time, you know.
Yep.
But yeah, with it being the longest one, I kind of have to assume it's not.
We're going to get something substantial, and I can see us having maybe a solid release date. Because I think this game's farther along than it might feel. Just because the whole thing of like Jason Schreier, who obviously we trust here, said that it was planned for like around the time Last of Us Part 2 was coming out, maybe, or a little after that. Yeah. But it was pushed back just because The Last of Us 2 was pushed back as well. So I think it might be in a state where they're willing to give a solid release date for it.
Yeah.
Especially to hype people up at the Game Awards.
I think so too. I think that sounds right.
Yeah. So that's it for the state of play stuff, blah, blah, blah. I'll just do a quick rundown of the important things for the indies thing, and we can get out of here.
There we go.
Okay, so the big announcements. Well, the biggest announcement, Indie Darling Axiom Verge is getting a sequel.
Hoo-wee! I know people love that game.
Yep, people love it. It looks dope.
I want to play Axiom Verge, yeah.
Sports Story is a sequel to the RPG Golf Story.
Which
also looks really, really good.
And people really love that too.
I think this was a really good thing as far as the beginning and end, and the stuff in the middle were good, of course. So they started with Sports Story and ended with Axiom Verge 2. So you're ending and closing with sequels to two big indie darling, like especially big on the sequels. Switch.
Yeah, I didn't even know either of them were getting sequels.
Yeah. But Axiom Verge 2 is a year away, it is fall 2020. Sports Story is mid-2020. So it's a little bit away, which is fun. But Skatebird is coming late 2020, unfortunately.
Mm.
But
We already knew Skatebird was coming here, didn't we?
On Switch?
Yeah.
I think so.
But
Game Pass, baby.
Yeah, that's where we saw it recently. I knew we saw it somewhere recently.
This interesting game called Gleam Light looked pretty neat. Let's see. Super Smash.
What? Indie Super Smash Bros. All the time.
So, Darby, this game, I'm going to read the description here. Super Smash, coming in May, is set in a game shop owned by a brother and sister who discover the mysterious game console. Every time they turn it on, it matches different genres together. Look cool. They describe this game, Darby, as a game that makes games.
Dreams?
Yeah. So, what you do is you pick two different genres like platformer and JRPG, and it combines them to make a game. It looks really neat. Here's also the interesting thing.
Actually,
pull up the trailer for this one just while we're talking. You can look at this thing's coming out in May on Switch, but It launched on the Epic Games Store today.
Okay.
So if this looks really neat, we can just go ahead.
What was the name of it?
Super Mash. It's one word, but it should. Let's
see. Super Mash.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
Stadia.
Stadia.
Something we will never use for a while, I guess. I don't know.
Okay.
Super Mash looks cool. Boyfriend Dungeon. It's a dungeon crawler dating sim where you use use weapons to go through dungeons and stuff, but then those weapons turn into beautiful people and you date them.
Okay.
My dream game.
So this is just one of those things, like they have a pre-made thing for whatever combination of
games. It may sound like it's not, but it probably is. I don't know.
Yeah.
But it looks deep.
Or is it procedurally generated?
Might be procedurally generated. I don't know.
Huh.
It looks crazy. It looks fun.
It does look pretty crazy. They're saying something with a, like, is it supposed to be like a party game or?
I guess whatever you want kind of game.
Seems very like.
Look at that cat. And the graphic styles is different and all that, yeah. So it's very interesting.
This is crazy. This is another like hard to sell thing, but this. I am intrigued. You have my attention.
This is one of the ones people seem to be most interested in, based on this, other than the obvious ones.
Yeah.
Let's see, there's the developers of How to Fool Boyfriend are teaming with the composer of Ace Attorney Murder by Numbers, a combo of visual novel and Picross.
What's Picross?
The whole the number thing, you know, where it's a grid
like
and you do
Sudoku
the numbers.
Or the
that kind of thing.
Okay, you lost me.
Yeah, I know, I did it for a lot of people too.
Yeah.
The Survivalist, the pixel art survival online multiplayer game from Team 17. And the classic shooter Oddworld Strangers Wrath is coming to Switch in January. And that was it. Oh, wait. Also, Dauntless and the Talos Principle Deluxe Edition are out on the Switch right now. There are also some other ones. Streets of Rage 4 is coming first half, and then a couple other neat looking games.
All right. Well, cool.
So, solid little Nindy Direct thing.
Solid day of announcements.
Good way to warm up for those sweet, sweet Game Awards.
I'm
feeling the hype.
Feel loose, feel ready.
Because honestly, I'm hoping this is not Jeff revealing all the big announcement before, but we are getting some pretty good stuff, like the people, a new game reveal from the people formerly of Arcane. The Half-Life Alyx stuff. I'm just curious to see more of that. Just in general.
Me too.
Ghost of Tsushima and a bunch of other stuff. Apparently Green Day is revealing a game.
It's a Green Day fighting game.
Yep.
But no, we talk about self-awareness. I think Jeff knows that the catching people off guard is one of the like biggest lasting impressions that Game Awards can have. Yeah, I think he knows to at least save enough. I mean, like, you kind of have to do the balance. You have to, like, reveal enough to get people to tune in, but then...
He's been announcing those presenters, and they've been pretty good so far. Got some Muppets in there. Richie.
There were there Muppets before. There's, like, a weird Muppet synergy with the Game Awards.
Yeah. You got Reggie. You got, what's her name? The girl that was with Bethesda, the Japanese
left. Yeah, I can't remember her name, but I know who
she's gonna be there.
That was with Ghostwire Tokyo. Yeah.
Oh, I hope we see more of that game.
All right. Well, make sure that on December 12th, Tuesday or Thursday, man, it's time to go to bed.
2 days from now, Darby.
2 days from now, we are going to be streaming the Game Awards live at twitch.tv/nerdsatlargegaming at around 8 p.m. Eastern time. I'm excited. Monokuma's excited. Jeff's excited.
Always.
It's going to be pretty sweet.
And we'll have Jacob.
Yeah. Hopefully we'll have Jacob. I guess we don't know 100%, but we're expecting to have Jacob. And if we don't have him, we'll never talk to him again. All right. Thanks. Bye.
Bye.